Namaste, Assalamu Alaikum, and a big hello. Welcome to the Nehru Center, London. This is Rageshwari, and I'm so excited to be bringing to you a very special show today. The Gandhi Jayanti special, 150 years of celebrating the Mahatma. Today, we're bringing to you amazing anecdotes, inspiring talks, rare pictures. So lovely family members and children, we're so happy that you're joining us today. To start our show, let me welcome Her Excellency, the High Commissioner of India to the UK, Srimati Gayatri Kumar.
Thank you, Rageshwari ji. I'd like to emphasize that Mahatma Gandhi is not only revered as the father of the Indian nation, but for the world, he is a universal icon, an apostle of truth and nonviolence, whose principles and message to all generations are as relevant today in all parts of the world as they were in his time. He never claimed to have invented new philosophies, but only that these eternal truths must be embraced and practiced by all. And he emphasized the virtues of these principles. He adhered to the same principles that he taught in every moment of his life. And what accounts for Gandhiji's unique stature in the world? His life and work profoundly influenced political developments in countries that shared the same aspirations as the people of India across the continents. And he led India's international movement as a social reformer, a religious thinker, and a prophet. And even though he lived in the most violent century that mankind has known, he taught non-violence. As a social reformer, he experimented with the abolition of untouchability and the revival of handicrafts and the importance of sustainable development. He was a devoted Hindu, but he had a strong interest in other religions. He warned against individual greed and the immorality of modern technology. And the years of his most intense political activity were the years that witnessed the rise of Bolshevism and the rise and fall of fascism, two world wars, and the growth of national movements in Asia and Africa. So these were the times in which this prophet emerged. India was, while we had this mass non-violent movement led by Gandhiji in India, Mao Zedong was initiating revolutionary change in China. Gandhiji's example, however, inspired statesmen and leaders of the caliber of Martin Luther King, Nelson Mandela, and the Dalai Lama, and Aung San Suu Kyi. His techniques of nonviolence have endured, and the essence of his philosophy was that the empowerment of the individual was supreme, the most important objective. And he considered democracy as its institutional form. It was clear that democracy meant democratic institutions, respect for the rights of all human beings, and that it was about tolerance, protecting dignity and self-respect of every human being. And his main message, which was way ahead of his times in that last century, was that the progress of the individual could not be separated from the preservation of Mother Earth. Today, as the world addresses the ever closer imminent danger of our planet being choked by gases and emissions and plastics and e-waste, Gandhiji's ideas about sustainability come plainly to mind. He had said the oft-quoted phrase, "The world has enough for everyone's need, but not enough for everyone's greed." And I must say that long before the international community came together to articulate the concept of sustainable development through the Brundtland Commission report, Mahatma Gandhi had already reminded the world that sustainability was vital to secure the future of the planet. In fact, he had gone further and actually identified threats to humanity's shared future through mindless consumerism. his book, Hind Swaraj, became a manifesto on sustainable development. And at that time, we found his prognosis gloomy because according to him, urban industrial civilization carried the seeds of its own destruction. But today, we realize that each word had a ring of truth. And even though he had mentioned them more than 100 years ago during a meeting in Ahmedabad in 1918. So Gandhiji actually conceptualized India's independence in terms of its people's access to air, water and grain. He was a firm proponent of the idea that afforestation and rainwater harvesting could help address water scarcity. And his simple motto continues to inspire us, which is, and I quote, "One must care about the world that one will not see," unquote. He had believed that humanity can only claim to have progressed when it has collectively fulfilled its obligation to the world and responsibility to the future. So more than six decades after his passing, Gandhiji's life and legacy are still very much alive today. The imprint of his ideals are clearly seen in the policies framed and pursued by Government of India in all the areas of our activity, including foreign policy. India over the years has pursued an active role in regional and international affairs to promote peace, including our contribution to UN peacekeeping missions since 1948, our policy of non-interference in the affairs of other sovereign states, advocacy of human rights and rule of law, universal disarmament, respect for international law, our preference for moderation and our firm belief in peaceful settlement of disputes, our consistent support for the developmental agenda of countries across the continents, all this is influenced by the philosophy of Gandhi. We in India have rededicated ourselves to his immortal philosophy that non-violence is the greatest force at the disposal of mankind, that it is mightier than the mightiest weapon of destruction devised by the ingenuity of man. These are his famous words. And we must always keep those uppermost in our minds. As you know that in June, on June 15, 2007, the UNGA had unanimously resolved to observe his birth anniversary, October 2nd, as the International Day of Nonviolence, and to remind the world of the Gandhian ideals of truth and non-violence, Government of India, under the leadership of Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi in 2018, had launched a worldwide two-year celebration of Gandhiji's 150th birth anniversary. In 2019, at the United Nations, Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi, along with the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres and other world leaders, had inaugurated the Gandhi Solar Park and Gandhi Peace Garden at the UN headquarters, underlining that Gandhiji's principles should be considered a moral compass and should be adhered to as the world grapples with challenges of climate change, terrorism, and other global issues. And the Gandhi Solar Park is a first of its kind symbolic Indian effort at the UN that highlights India's willingness to go beyond just talk on climate change and climate action. At a contribution of about $1 million, India gifted solar panels that were installed on the roof of the UN headquarters, one panel each for every one of the 193 UN member states. And the solar panels were powered up to reach a maximum of 50 kilowatts of generation power. And that energy generated was equivalent to energy that would have been created through the use of 30,000 kilograms of coal. So India has been informing the UN of the many climate change initiatives undertaken by us, including reducing our dependency on fossil fuels, increasing our renewable energy capacity, greening our transport sector, India's water and life mission for water conservation, for rainwater harvesting and development of water resources, and of course the International Solar Alliance, and India's launch of the Coalition for Disaster Resilient Infrastructure, and our movement to end the use of single-use plastic, which was launched on Gandhi Jayanti last year. So a number of events and programs have been synchronized across the globe, and our High Commission is proud to be part of this global commemoration, and we have taken some unique initiatives to bring Mahatma Gandhi, father of our nation, and his philosophy to our friends and our Indian community across the UK. We've announced many of these on our website, and I hope that many of our community will join. And with these words, I would like to sincerely thank the distinguished participants in today's virtual celebration and in this panel. Gandhiji had coined the simple word Sarvodaya, which means universal upliftment and progress for all. His motto was simple living and high thinking. And I would like to end by leaving these words with you on behalf of the people of India and all the officers of the Indian High Commission in London. I thank you and wish you all good health and happiness. Jai Hind. It is a great honor and a privilege to be joined by you all in offering floral tribute, virtual floral tribute to Mahatma Gandhi, the father of our nation.
In a gentle way, you can shake the world. What a memorable quote by Gandhiji, and truly stands the test of time and truly needed in today's times. Up next, we have Lord Rami Ranger, CBE, Baron of Mayfair, Member, House of Lords.
Hello, this is Lord Ranger, Chairman of the British Sikh Association. It is my proud privilege and honor to pay tribute to the father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhi, on his 151st birth anniversary. I shudder to think what would have been the future of 1.3 billion of us if it wasn't for the vision and commitment of Gandhiji. He rose to the occasion, gave up everything he had, comfortable life, for a cause which was very dear to him. That was the freedom of his mother India. Bapuji was not only an Indian leader. In fact, he was a global icon. He shaped the world as we see it today. The civil rights movement in America under Martin Luther King was inspired by Gandhiji. The struggle against apartheid by Nelson Mandela was yet another example. Bapuji made such an impact that more countries issued stamp in honor of Bapuji than any other political leader in the world. History is littered with leaders who use violence to gain their independence. But Gandhiji was totally against violence. He believed that if people become violent, they will remain violent even after the objectives are met. So he never used violence because every life was dear to him. I was very proud to have donated £100,000 towards a statue in Parliament Square, right in front of British Parliament, because he defied what was being produced in that Parliament against India and prevailed. So it is a great honor for me to salute the leader who not only inspired Indian but the population across the world. Jai Bapu, Jai Hind.
One of my other favorite quotes by Gandhiji is, "My life is my message." How wonderful. Also, be the change that you wish to see. So I think this is so powerful and such a subtle, beautiful message for parents or for bosses or conglomerate heads that we don't really have to ask people to change. We need to be that change and we can inspire people the same way. Up next is C.V. Patel, Chairman, the India League.
Thank you, Rageshwari ji. Namaskar, Your Excellency, the High Commissioner for India, Srimati Gayatri ji, the Deputy High Commissioner, other officers of India House, the worshipful Mayor of the London Borough of Camden, and all the distinguished friends. Gandhi ji always made virtue out of necessity. Corona has come, the world is worrying. I appreciate the initiative of India House and Nehru Center to organize this very important event through this modern technology. Prime Minister of India, Sri Narendra Modi, called it a pious day, a historic day. 2nd October is not just an ordinary day. Many years ago, a man was born, or a child was born rather, who became a great man called Mahatma Gandhi. 70 years ago, he passed away. The man has gone, but the message is universal and omnipresent. Gandhi's message of peace, non-violence, tolerance, defiance of oppression through his own unique method is very helpful, more important today than it was before. In the last few years, sadly, all over the world, more lives have been lost, more blood has been shed due to terrorism, hunger, famine, internecine warfares. What for? Gandhiji could have applied many methods. The oppression on India was many decades old, perhaps many centuries old. Gandhiji devised a method which won the adversaries as friends. So today we have come here as a chairman of the India League, and if I may say so, on behalf of about 2 million British Indians, let me thank the High Commissioner and everybody else and the Mayor of Camden for this occasion. For last 50 years, the Gandhiji came in Tavistock Square in June 1968. From October 68, every time, 2nd October and 30 January, we've assembled here. It's my privilege to be here almost every time. And why we come here? I must acknowledge that the Lenders of Camden, where we were discussing with on behalf of India League for this site, in the presence of the High Commissioner, the previous High Commissioner and Christian Mandan, who was the counselor in Camden, they're very cooperative. They gave us a prime site for India. Gandhiji in Tavistock Square is the first Gandhiji statue in the world's capital or over the world. I also would like to say only two things here. Today India is different than what India was when Gandhiji was born in 1869 or when Gandhiji was assassinated in 1948. Today India is itself, I'm not talking power and regional power or superpower, but India has a message. All over the world, the India is respected for many things. India's soft power is very unique. The yoga, the vegetarian, the respect to nature, and many more things. But more important, Gandhiji's message. Anywhere you go, people just know India through Gandhiji. So, Gandhiji, Gandhi Bapu, we come here, we pray, not as a ritual, but this is a moment for us to reflect, to pause, how we can individually and as a mass
live happily with our neighbors, with our adversaries. So High Commissioner, once again, I'm very grateful to you. You are the third Nari Shakti High Commissioner from India. And I must say, Gandhiji also gave emphasis to the Naris. They were very oppressed when Gandhiji came in 1915 from India or in South Africa. Gandhiji gave voice to the voiceless, not only untouchables and others and tribals, but the women of India. And I'm glad the present Indian government also is giving a lot of importance to Nari Shakti's evolution and even in the all aspects of life. So Srimati Gayatri Ji, you represent the Nari Shakti. Once again, I'm most grateful to you. Thank you very much.
Another memorable quote by Gandhiji is, where there is love, there is life. Many wise men and wise women have said that there's not a dearth of food, but there's definitely a dearth of love. So one fine and memorable message that we can actually imbibe in our lives is to be loving, not just with our family members, with our community. As Gandhiji very beautifully said, that hate the sin and not the sinner. So entire intention on his birthday should not just be where empty rituals are concerned, but to truly celebrate his virtues. Up next is Lord Meghnad Desai, Member House of Lords.
Mahatma Gandhi's statue in London reminds us how much he valued London. He came to London as an 18-year-old student studying at the Inner Temple. But it was while he was in London that he acquired a lot of the beliefs and strengths that helped him through the rest of his life. The vegetarians whom he befriended among the English gave him the confidence that his vegetarianism was a good thing. He learned to agitate and to lobby. He learned how to relate to people. He learned about health and about his own religion. He acquired the knowledge of the Bhagavad Gita while he was in London through his English friends. He said once that if he was not fighting for India's independence, he would love to live in London forever. On the 151st anniversary of his birth, let us remember that London meant a lot to Gandhiji. He gave a lot to London, and not just London, through London to the whole world. This is what we remember today on 2nd of October 2020.
Dear friends, that was such an inspiring talk by Lord Desai. Now friends, as you know that this is the Gandhi Jayanti special being brought to you by the Nehru Center in London. It's the 151st birth anniversary of our Mahatma. And we have an iconic speaker up next. He also happens to be the director of our Nehru Center right here in UK. And he is also an iconic author and a path-breaking philanthropist. And he's going to share some very interesting pictures. Now, a whole lot of Gandhians also get surprised sometimes seeing rare pictures of our Mahatma. So let's get started and let's welcome everybody's favorite author and a director who we truly love, Amish Tripathi.
Hi, Rageshwari. What a pleasure to be in conversation with you again. You're like my sister. So this is like a relaxed conversation in the drawing room.
Absolutely. And it's so wonderful to be talking about Mahatma Gandhi on such a special anniversary, 151st birth anniversary. And there are some wonderful pictures that you're going to share with us. I'm absolutely intrigued by the first one.
Absolutely. You know, this is based on a book that has, all these pictures have been drawn from a book that we received from Pramod Kapoor of Roly Books. You know, the chief of Roly Books, a brilliant publisher and an author in his own right. And we must, of course, acknowledge him for his kindness in sharing this. And I thought that we could pull out a few of the photographs of Mahatma Gandhi. It's a lovely coffee table book. Which has unseen photographs and, you know, the stories behind those photographs. You really get an insight into the Mahatma's life. He is one of the most analyzed figures in human history, Mahatma Gandhi. So it's almost impossible for anyone to find something new about him. And that's what was so wonderful about this book, that we discovered so many new things. So I'm going to begin with a photograph that our wonderful tech team is just going to display out here. A photograph of Mahatma Gandhi from birth, you know, from close to his birth till almost, 948. So here is the photograph.
Amish, before you go on, because this picture is remarkable as people are going to be viewing it and, of course, ordering the copy of the book as well. But because you're so iconic, and now that we're seeing the picture from birth till his old age, tell me, when was the first time when you heard about Mahatma Gandhi? Obviously, when you were a child, but the first experience, because I remember my first experience, which I'll tell you later, but you go ahead first.
Fantastic question. I would have been in Odisha at that time. I used to live in this small place called Kanswal, close to Rourkela. And it would have been in school. I used to study in this school called Uthmal English Primary School, a tiny school out there. And I think on October 2nd, I would have been maybe 4 or 5 years old. Those are among my earliest memories, you know, was essentially celebrating Mahatma Gandhi on October 2nd, and the father of the nation. And we were, of course, given a brief speech about him and that he defeated the British without arms and with the force of non-violence and with moral force. We understood a little. I was 5 at that time, so I'm not so sure I understood everything. But I pretty much understood that he was quite a man.
No, but it's so amazing because those are those lovely, you know, seeds that are planted in a child's mind. And that's why it's so important that we have a whole lot of families who are tuning in and are part of the Nehru Center community. And that's what we've been constantly saying, that listen, it's so important for children to know about his philosophies. So I was just a little girl too, you know, when my father made me see Richard Attenborough's Gandhi. And at that time, it made me so sad, but he would just make me see it all the time. And as you grow, the philosophies then grow deeper and deeper and then take over your life. So it's so interesting for all the children. Let's get back to the pictures, Amish. Thank you.
Seen in the movie where he's burning his ID card in South Africa and someone is whipping him again and again. He doesn't respond, but he keeps, you know, putting those papers. Like, what strength, you know, the moral strength. I remember that scene as a child. And what we were, you know, when we discovered Mahatma Gandhi, the age we were at, it's wonderful to see a photograph of him at the same age. You know, so here I am looking at a photograph of him in 1876. He was born in 1869. So he would have been, you know, 7 years old at this time, 6 or 7 at this time. And this is like a collage of his photographs from 1876 till 1948.
Wow.
And in a way, through these photographs, you see the journey of his life. How when he was young, he was almost completely, you know, judging just by his veshbhusha, by his clothes, completely Indian, right? And then he has this phase of being westernized, right? The time when he's exposed to the UK, which was, you know, the Western world, the dominant culture of that time, you know, and you find till 1911, I mean, all his clothes are all westernized. He's in a proper suit and a tie, as often as I wear at events. But today for Mahatma Gandhi, I'm, of course, wearing an Indian kurta. And you find from 1913 onwards, all his clothes, everything is completely Indian. And one would love to cover his entire life journey, but regrettably, we don't have a 48-hour program. We can speak only for 10 minutes. So, I was thinking that how about if we cover just one aspect of his remarkable life, and cover the part when he actually, because we are in London. So how about covering a part of his life when he came to London, you know, and photographs of that journey, not in his early years, but the time when he came in 1931. And those are the photographs that we will explore, you know, and I'd love to discuss them with you.
So, cannot wait.
The first photograph is the one taken in 1931, where Mahatma Gandhi has been photographed before departing for London to attend the second roundtable conference. In the picture, our front row, left to right, you can of course see that Madan Mohan Malviyaji on the left. I'm sure you're aware, my family comes from Banaras, right? From Kashi, my father's family. And Madan Mohan Malviya ji had actually founded the Banaras Hindu University. And he used to run this charity program for underprivileged but talented children.
Yeah.
And among the people who benefited from that was actually my grandfather, Pandit Babulal Tripathi. So my entire family are everything, are, you know, our destiny changed thanks to Madan Mohan Malviya ji's charity, right? Because my grandfather, from an underprivileged little child having no scope, suddenly became educated and became a teacher, right? That's why for us, he's, Madan Mohan Malviya ji is almost like a, you know, like a god for us. So here he was with Mahatma Gandhi. And then to the left of Mahatma Gandhi, to our right is Sarojini Naidu ji. She's facing away from the camera. And of course, Kasturba Gandhi ji, who is at the far right. This photograph was apparently taken on 29th August 1931 when Mahatma Gandhi boarded the SS Rajputana in Mumbai, then Bombay, to sail to London to attend the second roundtable conference. He was accompanied, as I said earlier, by Madan Mohan Malviya ji, Sarojini Naidu ji, his son Devdas, as well as Mirabhen, which was the Indian name of Madeleine Slade, we all know that, who considered Mahatma Gandhi a spiritual father. And the industrialist G.T. Birla ji was also accompanying them. A huge crowd had gathered to see them off. And apparently Mahatma Gandhi had said, there's every chance I will return empty-handed. But once on board, he seemed in a jovial mood, joking with the captain about being his prisoner. He was a prisoner on sea and was seen enjoying himself on the ship's bridge. We will see a little more of the journey, you know, as we go on. But I thought this is a remarkable thing to see who were the people who went with him, you know, to the roundtable conference. And many of them have not been covered in that iconic Gandhi movie. So we don't know that much about them, about Sarojini Naidu ji, Mirabhen, we know a little bit, Madan Mohan Malviya ji. But they were very, very important characters in Mahatma Gandhi's life as well.
And this journey to London, iconic.
And the journey to London. And then we have the next photograph. Is again at 1931, Mahatma Gandhi bidding farewell to his countrymen before his ship set sail for England. So he's, as you can see, he's on the balcony. The people I described just earlier were again standing next to him, and Mahatma Gandhi is saying goodbye to all his friends. Mahatma Gandhi and his party were booked into second class cabins, obviously. He did not travel first class. On an inspection tour, he noticed that Mahadev Desai and some others had brought a large number of leather suitcases, and the cabins were heaped with expensive luggage. There was even an American-made folding camp bed that someone had gifted for Mahatma Gandhi to use as a disc chair, as a deck chair. And Mahatma Gandhi said, "What is all this?" And then Mirabhen explained that these things had been collected in the haste of last-minute preparations for the voyage. To which Mahatma Gandhi retorted, "If you want to travel with such luggage, you should live with those who like it."
So wonderful.
He personally saw to it that the seven suitcases and the trunks were offloaded at Aden, which is on the Arabian Peninsula, on the way to London to be shipped back to Mumbai, then Bombay.
I love that. You know, there's also such an interesting anecdote that Gandhiji, of course, had so many followers and very diverse followers. And some of them were also these very rich women who would dress up in some very exquisite clothes and bags and would come to him. And then he would say, "Excuse me, you have no idea the kind of people I work for. And if you want to work for me, please go back. Dress up in something that's more Indian and something that's more minimalistic or simple."
Very, very, very so that's what made him so inspiring, right? Just because he had power and you know, and a hold over so many people, he didn't use that for his own personal aggrandizement. Those are the kind of leaders that Indians like. You know, we always prefer a Lord Ram as compared to, say, a Dhritarashtra, right? Someone who will live a simple life and focus more on his people.
Yeah, and it's also so, and that's why I guess everybody was so drawn to him. Because you feel comfortable with someone who is just so simple and humble.
True. Very true. Very true. And the next photograph that I'm going to show you, again from this remarkable collection which is shared with us by Pramod Kapoor. It's again on his ship. You see Mahatma Gandhi, looking at the sea, you know, at the, you know, standing at the balcony. No, he doesn't have his arms stretched out screaming, "I'm the king of the world," like in Titanic. He's just contemplatively looking at the sea. And following his routine of writing letters, spinning and reading, Gandhiji spent most of his days on the deck of the ship, you know, with the open air. And the next photograph, I thought I'll just show you that as well. And then I'll read out the description. The next photograph has Mahatma Gandhi sitting on the deck again and working. You know, you can see clearly he is writing either some notes or a letter. And Mirabai is seen lying on the ground taking a nap. And so on board the SS Rajputana, Gandhiji had insisted that he and his party should travel by the lowest class, which was classified as second class. However, since he was such a famous passenger, the captain invited him to the bridge where he examined the sextant, and Gandhiji even steered the ship for a brief period. Okay, this I didn't know, that he actually steered a ship, a massive SS Rajputana itself, a massive ship. He spent all his time on the ship's deck, meeting other passengers, playing with children, and choosing one corner where he could receive visitors and dictate letters. Aboard the ship, his routine was exactly like it was at the ashram. He would rise early for prayers and then spend time on the deck spinning, writing letters, and eating food that had been bought specially for him, mainly fruit and goat's milk. At the Suez, he received a telegram from Nahas Pasha, leader of the Egyptian Waqf Party, addressed to the great leader, Al Mahatma Gandhi. Once, as you know, in the Middle East, you know, they use the term Al as a form of respect. So the great leader, Al Mahatma Gandhi. And once the ship docked, a horde of Egyptian cameramen came on board and took photographs showing him in a relaxed mood, as if he did not know he was being photographed. So this is a remarkable thing. You get a sense of the journey as well and how he traveled. And you see him at work and in a way being just Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi rather than being Gandhiji the leader, you know, just with his friends, being himself, working, contemplating, looking at the sea. These are remarkable photographs to see. And the next photographs, I want to show you a set of what are cartoons and and some articles, which is when Mahatma Gandhi met the king. And of course, an article published in a British newspaper at the time, which says Gandhi sips boiled goat's milk at tea given by king. And of course, another one with the UK press, an article saying Gandhi to go to king's party in loincloth. Clearly, they were horrified by that. And there is a cartoon.
For him to wear what he did, because he just completely...
He's going to be himself. And so there is a cartoon where you see, King George V seated, shaking hands with Mahatma Gandhi, who is dressed in a loincloth and with a shawl around him. Queen Mary is sitting next to King George V, and Madan Mohan Malviya ji is sitting next to Mahatma Gandhi, and Sarojini Naidu is sitting there as well. So these, as you can clearly see, this is the cartoon that has been drawn up. And if I can describe this, Gandhiji reached London on 12th September 1931. Those days, journeys took a long time. I mean, today, traveling from India to the UK doesn't take that long. But okay, it took some 2 weeks in those days. Gandhiji reached London on 12th September 1931 for the second roundtable conference. While in London, he was invited to Buckingham Palace for tea with King George V and Queen Mary. He arrived wearing a dhoti, sandals, a shawl, and his dangling watch. So we should clarify that regardless of what the British press was worried about, that he'd land up in a loincloth, he'd worn a dhoti, right? Maybe they thought it's a loincloth, but it was a dhoti which came up to the knee. Later, when asked whether he was wearing enough clothing, Mahatma Gandhi replied, "The king had enough for the both of us."
What an amazing sense of humor, and through that, actually talking about exactly what the plight was, where, because he just wanted to be like the common man.
Yeah, and what the Indians had been suffering at the hands of the British Raj. King George was a gruff character, clearly not amused at the letters he had been receiving from his viceroys about the little upstart Gandhi. He expressed his disapproval to Gandhiji, especially about the boycott of his son, the Prince of Wales, during his visit to India. Gandhiji replied, "I did not boycott your son, Your Majesty. but the official representative of the British Crown. Now, this is one truly one of the remarkable things about Mahatma Gandhi, how he could deliver tough messages, but in a very polite and well-mannered way, you know, that and he could differentiate between the individual and the post that he represented. This is something that perhaps we can learn in today's day, where there's so much negativity, and we don't see things in a nuanced way. He was willing to see even the, you know, the royal crown and those who were at the top of the Raj that were oppressing India in a nuanced way.
A nuanced way, you're right. And he was so forward-thinking because, you know, I mean, today scientists and metaphysicists talk about the frequency and vibrational energy of love. He sort of turned it into a broad-scale movement. So he just sort of knew the power of subtlety, of soft powers, that it can actually sustain much more than revenge or temper or anger.
And at the same time, being polite doesn't mean that you have to become a doormat, you know, and accept crimes being committed against you. That's not the way his approach was at all. So, I mean, if you, there's another, you know, the conversation carries on that it says that the king apparently then told Gandhiji, "I won't have you stirring up trouble in my empire." To which Gandhiji maintained a dignified silence. Visibly annoyed, Gandhiji, when asked about the meeting later, said it had been a boring affair. So, you know, he was willing to be polite, but he wasn't willing to be rolled over either. Now, I think that balance is a very critical balance to strike. And I think that's something that perhaps all of us can learn from.
Beautiful. So what's the next picture?
So the next picture is again in 1931, Gandhiji recording for the Columbia Broadcasting Company at Kingsley Hall, London. You can see people around him suitably suited and booted. But of course, Mahatma Gandhi is still in his dhoti, which the British called a loincloth, but it's actually a dhoti. Okay.
And I love the message he chose. So it's so amazing that he wanted it to be a non-political speech.
The Columbia Broadcasting Company, one of the premier music and recording companies of the time, requested that Gandhiji record a speech for posterity. He agreed to the recording, but only if it were non-political in nature, and chose to read one of his old published articles on God, an unseen power that defied proof. So lovely.
Brilliant.
And then, you know, pretty much like him, like Mahatma Gandhi did with the Columbia Broadcasting Company. So we are going to follow this, his, you know, his, we're going to hold him up as a role model and follow his way. So we are not going to talk any politics either, which is why you'll notice in the pictures, you've stayed away from politics and speaking of him as a person. And therefore, the last photograph is also a suitably non-political one. This is of, again in 1931, Gandhiji with the great Hollywood actor and showman, Charlie Chaplin.
It's the first time I've ever seen Charlie Chaplin without a mustache.
Correct. and not looking clownish. Right?
I know. there is Charlie Chaplin. And I love the conversation between them. So
he actually looks dignified. So I don't know if it is the absence of the clownish costume or the presence of Mahatma Gandhi.
Definitely the latter.
So, Charlie Chaplin was keen to meet Gandhiji. Gandhiji had never heard of Chaplin or seen his movies. And when told that Chaplin came from a poor family, Gandhiji agreed to meet him. They had an animated discussion about machinery, which Chaplin felt was a great boon to mankind. But Gandhiji's view was that it made India dependent on Great Britain. And the only way to reduce that dependency was to boycott all machinery. Gandhiji sold the idea of the spinning wheel and homespun cloth to Charlie Chaplin. This is the last picture that I'm going to be sharing with you, because after this, then it goes into the second conference where it gets political, where it's best that we keep out of it. But, you know, and to use Mahatma Gandhi's own approach to life, there's so much that we can learn from him. But it's not that we have to agree with him on everything. You know, like, for example, his views on machinery. No, I mean, I think it's good. It improves productivity. It, you know, it has raised lifestyles across the world. you know, the Industrial Revolution, which began, you know, more than a century ago, has greatly improved lifestyle, and the tech revolution that we are undergoing right now will pull us up even more. But there are many things that we can learn from him as well, and nothing as you know, as profound as the ability to see things in a nuanced way. Don't see things as simplistic black and white. You know, someone who's just who sits on the other side is not necessarily evil. It doesn't mean that you have to be a doormat and get rolled over, but see things in a nuanced way, and you'll find that the world actually improves. Often, you know, the worst crimes are committed by those who believe in a simplistic good and evil approach to life, rather than the traditional Indian way of seeing things in a nuanced way. That there's some good in our enemies as well, and there's some areas of improvement in us as well.
True, and I love one of his most amazing quotes is, "Hate the sin, but not the sinner." So he sort of, you know, I think that says it all, that he just welcomed and nurtured people and then just guided us beautifully. And also the beauty about, you know, bringing India together, because he always was so concerned about the villages. And so it's so lovely for him to present it. I hope he presented the spinning wheel to Charlie Chaplin. Or
apparently he did, but I don't have photographic evidence of that. So we're going to have to trust Pramod Kapoor. And once again, thanks to Pramod Kapoor of Rolling Books for donating these, for sending these photographs to us, which we could showcase in this program. And thank you so much, Rageshwari, for allowing me to show these photographs.
Thank you, Amish. It's always an honor and a pleasure to chat with you. And on behalf of you, and of course, behalf of the Nehru Center London, we'd like to thank Pramod Kumarji and Roli Books. But for now, we're going to have a wonderful chat with Satish Kumarji, and then he's going to interact with students. Let's have a look.
This is my great honor and pleasure to be invited to say a few words to celebrate the birth of Mahatma Gandhi. I'm most grateful to the High Commissioner in London, and also the Nehru Center. And particularly, I would like to thank Rageshwari for welcoming me and introducing me for this session. Mahatma Gandhi is my hero. When I was 18 years old, I was inspired by Mahatma Gandhi. When I read his book, his autobiography, I said that now I want to follow Gandhi's way of non-violence. Because Gandhi said that in everything, if we practice non-violence, that all our actions become sustainable, spiritual, and for the upliftment of all. That was his main message, Sarvodaya, upliftment of all. And that Sarvodaya philosophy of nonviolence goes beyond all the isms of political philosophies like capitalism, communism, socialism, liberalism, because all these isms are still human-centered. They are all talking about the well-being of humans. But Mahatma Gandhi was talking about Sarvodaya, which means well-being and upliftment of all living beings. Human beings, and also other than human beings. So his nonviolence was a message for all living beings. So we need to start practicing nonviolence in our personal lives. Mahatma Gandhi said that we have to be the change that we want to see in the world. If we don't be nonviolent to ourselves and don't make nonviolence as a way of life, then only preaching nonviolence to others is not make any difference. We have to radiate nonviolence like a radiator radiates heat. And when we are practicing nonviolence, when we are an example of nonviolence, when we are embodiment of nonviolence, then we will be able to influence others. So be nonviolent to yourself and be kind to yourself and forgive yourself and drop all the past regrets and a kind of guilt and any kind of the past, you are carrying the burden of hate and anger and fear. Let the burden go and embrace nonviolence to yourself. And then Mahatma Gandhi said that then you have to be non-violent to all other people, whether they are Hindus, Muslims, Christians, Buddhists, Europeans, Americans, Asians, Africans, whatever your caste, whatever your religion, whatever your nationality, whatever your political philosophy, never mind. We are all human beings. That was a deep and profound message for me. Because if I consider myself as one label and say this my label, whether I'm a Hindu or a Buddhist or a Christian or Brahmin or some other caste, upper caste, educated, anything. The moment I put myself under a label, I am isolating myself and disconnecting myself. But Mahatma Gandhi said that we are all interrelated. We are all interconnected. We are all interdependent. We are all one. The unity of life was his great message. The nonviolence principle and nonviolence philosophy is embedded in the principle of unity of life. So being nonviolent to all other people, irrespective of caste, class, religion, nationality, political philosophy, was such a profound message that inspired me to work as a Gandhian. And the third idea of Mahatma Gandhi, he said we have to go nonviolence even further than just being nonviolent to people. We have to be nonviolent to nature. The way we are treating nature as if we are trying to conquer nature. We cannot conquer nature. We are nature. Nature out there, the forests, the mountains, the animals, the birds, the oceans, the lakes are nature, but we are also nature. Humans and nature are one. There is no separation between nature and humans. Humans are also nature. That was Mahatma Gandhi's great idea. Because in our modern, particularly Western philosophy, we have separated. Separation, dualism, that nature out there, we humans here, and we control nature, we conquer nature, we subjugate nature, and we make nature serve human needs, and nature becomes a resource for the economy. Nature becomes a resource for profit, for consumption, for production. Mahatma Gandhi said, nature is not merely a resource for the economy, nature is a source of life itself. Nature is life. Nature is a miracle. Nature is a magical. Nature is a kind of life itself. So this was such a profound message for me, particularly at this time of sustainability, environmental crisis, ecological crisis, climate change, global warming, these big issues which face today. The humanity is obsessed with these big problems today. And so Mahatma Gandhi was ahead of his time. And he said that we must act in this world in such a frugal way, in such a simple living way, so that we do not take more than our share in the nature. So Mahatma Gandhi said, there's enough in the world for everybody's need, but not enough for anybody's greed. This was such a profound message for our time. So Mahatma Gandhi's time has not gone. Mahatma Gandhi's time is now, and Mahatma Gandhi's time is coming. The future is future of Mahatma Gandhi's message of equality, of frugality, of simplicity, of nonviolence, of living on this planet Earth frugally and a light footprint so that we don't destroy our planet Earth. The COVID crisis and the coronavirus that the world is facing today is a result of human nature relationship in such a way that we have been encroaching and exploiting nature and going into the wild nature and taking more and more and more of nature and going into mass production of food and cash crops of agriculture like soya beans being planted in rainforests of Brazil to be exported all over the world. This kind of encroachment of nature and destruction of nature bounces back and comes back into the form of many diseases and viruses such as coronavirus and COVID-19. So if we want to free ourselves from such disastrous consequences, then we have to listen to Mahatma Gandhi and practice nonviolence and nonviolence of mind, nonviolence of thought, nonviolence of speech, spiritual nonviolence, physical non-violence, emotional non-violence. Every level, we have to practice non-violence. That, I think, is the message of Mahatma Gandhi as the most relevant to our time. This is why I say Mahatma Gandhi's time is coming. So these are my brief thoughts about Mahatma Gandhi. And we are delighted to be celebrating Mahatma Gandhi's birthday on the 2nd of October today in London. And thank you, Nehru Center, for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to say a few words. And now I would, after my deep thanks and gratitude, I would like to also invite anyone who would like to ask some questions. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Shrestha Saxena, and I'm a financial math student at the London School of Economics. And my question is, how would the world or India be today if Mahatma Gandhi was never born?
Thank you, Shrestha, for your wonderful question. If Mahatma Gandhi was not born, we will be missing something very special. Like the Buddha, like Lao Tzu in China, like Jesus Christ, like Martin Luther King in America, these great figures come in the world to wake us up and solve certain problems of their time, but their message is not just for their time. Their message is for all times, for the future as well as for their own time. And therefore, if Mahatma Gandhi was not born, we will miss this new worldview, this holistic worldview, which I just explained, the principle of nonviolence at personal level, social level, spiritual level, and ecological level. Apart from that, of course, Mahatma Gandhi was one of the early champions of decolonization and bringing an end to imperialism. Under the British imperial power and colonial power, the sun never set. It was so big, east, west, north, south. It was all over the world, colonial power. Mahatma Gandhi stood up and said, colonialism and imperialism is not right for the humanity. So now we are almost free of imperialism and colonialism. That is thanks to Mahatma Gandhi and, of course, many other great leaders in India as well as around the world who followed his ideas and his lead and made the world a free world from colonialism and imperialism. So these are the two things which Mahatma Gandhi contributed, and we are very grateful for that.
Hi, my name's Ria, and I'm studying law at the University of Leeds. My question is, what would Mahatma Gandhi say to those who protest for important issues like the rights of minorities and the environment, but then themselves take to violence?
That's a very important question. Thank you, Ria. That's a very important to understand that we should not divide the ends and the means. We should pursue noble ends with noble means. So if our aim is to create a good society, society of equality, society of justice, society of compassion, then if we use wrong means, violent means, then we will not achieve a good end. So means and ends should congruent. Means and ends should be in good balance, good harmony. So if your aims are good and your means are violent and angry and fearful and conflict-ridden and destructive, then you are not going to reach good ends. There's no way to equality. There's no way to peace. Peace is the way. So we have to live those principles which we want to achieve in the world today. So this combination of means and means should be as good as the ends, is important principle of Mahatma Gandhi. And when you use violence, only few people can use violence. So majority of people cannot participate in the movement for transformation. And therefore, if we want to have everybody, men, women, children, old, young, black, white, anybody, educated, uneducated, whoever you are, everybody can participate in a movement if it is a non-violent movement. Therefore, all the great movements, such as Mahatma Gandhi's, but also Martin Luther King's movement for racial equality, and even largely the anti-apartheid movement of Nelson Mandela and many other movements for women's rights and many other movements for a kind of suffragette when women had to fight for their rights to vote. All these great movements in the world, in the history, had been non-violent and they have been very successful. So if your ends are non-violent and a good society, an equal society, then your means should also be non-violent. So this is the most important message of Mahatma Gandhi. I hope you understand. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Parvin and I study mechanical engineering at the University of Surrey. My question is, what are Mahatma Gandhi's messages for the environmental moment of today?
Thank you, Pavan, for your very good question. Mahatma Gandhi's message for the environmental movement today is that activism is good, working for the environment is good, but there are three kinds of environments. First of all, it's a natural environment, so we have to look after the nature. And secondly, social environment. So we also have to bring social justice in the world. Environmental justice and social justice are two sides of the same coin. We cannot have social justice without environmental justice, and we cannot have environmental justice without social justice. And then the third thing, which Mahatma Gandhi talked about, and which modern environmental movement need to pay attention very profoundly and deeply, is the third environment, is the spiritual environment. We have to embody the spiritual values of compassion to nature, compassion to people, kindness, generosity of spirit, and love for all living beings, equal status for all life, dignity of life, unity of life. These principles of spirituality and non-violence is fundamental to Mahatma Gandhi's message. So if the modern environmental movement can broaden its scope and bring social environment and spiritual environment and act out of love and compassion, rather than saying that world is wrong and government is wrong and business is bad and industry is bad and the petroleum companies are bad and we are good. So this kind of us and them, this kind of conflict is not Mahatma Gandhi's way. Mahatma Gandhi's way that we are all part of it and we all have to work together in order to change the world. And so we cannot make this us and them division. So this is the kind of message for the environmental movement from Mahatma Gandhi. Thank you, Pavan. I hope that you agree with this answer. Next question, please.
Hello, and namaste. My name is Parth Banaga, and I'm a pharmacology student at Queen Mary's University of London. My question for Professor Satish Kumar today is that why should we, modern British children, listen to an Indian leader from the previous century? And how would it benefit us? Thank you.
Thank you, Parth, for your good question. Why should we listen to anyone, not only somebody from the past, from India, but anyone, why should we listen? Wisdom is not a monopoly of any one person. And therefore, wherever there is a wisdom, we should take it, whether it's from the past, present, from India, from Africa, from America, from any part of the world. If there's a wisdom, if there are some good ideas, we should not shy in accepting those ideas. Because ideas, good philosophy, and good examples inspire us. So for many people, like myself included, Mahatma Gandhi is a great inspiration. Even though he lived maybe 70 or 80 years ago. But what he said about nonviolence, about simple living, about frugal living, about equality of all human beings, and good harmonious relationship between humans and nature, these are eternal values. They are timeless values. We cannot just say this is from the past and we forget it. Like I said, the teachings of the Buddha, or teachings of Jesus Christ, or teachings of Lao Tzu, or teachings of many, many other great philosophers and spiritual people. We have to listen to our ancestors, because without our ancestors, we will not be here. We should be grateful that we have been given so much wisdom through religions, cultures, philosophies, science, architecture, art, music, all from the past we have received. It could be Indian music, it could be Chinese art, it could be American architecture, it could be African architecture, it could be South American wisdom. Anywhere, if these things are being given to us as a gift, we should not look and deny the gift. So Mahatma Gandhi's message was a gift to the world, gift to future generations. And therefore, it is our great privilege that we have had people like Mahatma Gandhi teaching us such a great message. So we should be grateful and listen to Mahatma Gandhi and many other similar teachers, artists, poets. You can say, why should we listen to Shakespeare in India? We cherish Shakespeare in India. Why should we listen to Lao Tzu in Europe, who is a Chinese philosopher? So we should not limit ourselves within the boundaries of our country or our continent. We are world citizens, and our minds are big, and our hearts are generous, and we can accept good things wherever it comes from. Let the good ideas come from all corners of the world. That is Mahatma Gandhi's message, and I hope that you can listen to that message and embrace any good ideas coming from anywhere in the world.
Hello, I'm Daniel, and I am a student at Cheam High School. My question is what would Mahatma Gandhi say to those of us who hate mathematics and would burn out math textbooks?
Thank you for your question, and I'm interested to know that you don't like mathematics. You know, there are many ways of knowledge. Mathematics is only one way. Some people can find knowledge through philosophy. Some people can find knowledge through science. Somebody can find knowledge through art. So if you don't like mathematics, you don't have to go on that path. You can follow your heart and you can follow your interest. What do you like? Do you like to follow a path of philosophy or art or science or music or sociology? Just follow your blessing, follow your bliss, follow your interest. And don't worry if some other people want to follow mathematics. Why do you have to burn your books? Mahatma Gandhi was a non-violent person. He would not harm anyone. He will not hurt anyone. If somebody loves mathematics, what do you have, or what right do I have to burn the books and say nobody should read mathematics? So if you are not interested in mathematics, that's fine. It is your right not to study mathematics. You can say to your parents, you can say to your teachers, I don't want to study mathematics. I want to study something else. Follow your heart, follow your path, but don't try to stop other people reading mathematical books, because some people love mathematics. Some people would say that mathematics is next to God. Through mathematics, we can understand the whole world. Without mathematics, we cannot measure anything. And in order to build houses, you need to measure. In order to create technology, you need to measure. So all the physical and material progress we can make only through mathematics. So mathematics is a very important subject, and therefore those who want to pursue it, let them pursue it. But it should not be imposed on everybody. It should not be made necessary or compulsory for everybody. So if you are not interested in mathematics, you must be free to choose your path and follow your path. And that way you are free, but other people are also free to pursue their path. I hope you understand. Thank you.
My name is Andra. I study engineering. I would like to hear from the expert that what Gandhi will say to me if I want to cut down on my coffee. I actually drink a lot of coffee.
Thank you for your question. Mahatma Gandhi would say that any change comes step by step. If you like a lot of coffee at this moment, and you have a coffee in the morning, coffee at 11 o'clock, coffee after lunch, coffee at 4 o'clock, coffee after dinner, 4, 5, 6 times. Mahatma Gandhi said that becomes an addiction. And it is better not to be addicted to anything. And therefore, Mahatma Gandhi would advise you, and I would advise you as a follower of Mahatma Gandhi, that reduce your coffee intake. And maybe instead of 5 or 6 times, take only 3 times a day for a couple of weeks or a month. And then maybe take only 2 twice a day. And a little bit of coffee is fine. A little bit of tea is fine. A little bit in moderation, everything is okay. But if you become addicted to any one thing for too much, then it will have a negative impact, a negative effect on your physical health. And therefore, for your well-being, for your good health, for your good energy, I would advise to take coffee in moderation. That would be Gandhi's advice as well. Take coffee in moderation and maybe once or twice a day, and that's enough. I hope you understand. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Aditya Batra, and I go to Upton Court Grammar School in Slough in England. And I would like to say that I really, really like Gandhi's teachings that have inspired us even today. I like one of his quotes, which says that live life today as if there were no tomorrow. And my question is, if Gandhi was alive today, would he use the same methods, including non-violence, to prevent acts such as terrorism and crimes in our developed world, which is very, very, very different from what was there when he used to live on the in the world? Thank you.
Thank you, Aditya. It's a very good question. Yes, Mahatma Gandhi would say to the terrorists that instead of using violence for your cause, you should use non-violence. Terrorism breeds more terrorism. If you sow the seeds of violence, they will grow into trees of violence. Therefore, violence begets violence. Terrorism begets terrorism. Therefore, if you want to create a better, peaceful society, equality, human rights, all the good things that you want to achieve, your national pride, your religious integrity, you must pursue that through the way of persuasion. You must put good argument and good logic, and your love and your compassion will persuade people, and your love and compassion will inspire people and give you more rights, more justice, and accept your views in a much better way. So terrorism is not a right way. So Mahatma Gandhi will use non-violent way, even in the Western societies and Western cultures, because non-violence goes beyond borders. It's not limited to only India or Asia. Non-violent principles are applicable to all over the world. And you can see how Mahatma Gandhi was inspired and influenced movements like racial equality in America, led by Martin Luther King. And so he used non-violence in America, in a developed sort of industrialized society. So non-violent method is applicable everywhere. Middle East, whether it's Iran or Iraq or Afghanistan or Pakistan or India or China or Europe or America or South America or Africa, or wherever you are, non-violence is a principle for everywhere. So Mahatma Gandhi will advocate non-violence and try to mitigate the effects of terrorism. Thank you. Thank you all for inviting me to participate in this wonderful event at the Nehru Center. And I hope that the rest of the program and rest of the day, we celebrate Mahatma Gandhi and we pay our homage and our tribute to his work. But it is not only a matter of worshipping or praising Gandhi. Ultimately, Gandhi will want us to practice non-violence and truth in our own lives. So I hope that we can carry Mahatma Gandhi's message in our lives, not only for today, but every day, throughout the year and throughout our lives. Thank you very much.
The law of love can best be loved by children. What a wonderful quote. And Gandhiji absolutely loved children. And there are beautiful Gandhian schools all over India that actually have a beautiful philosophy, because Gandhiji never believed in dividing children, in separating children. He believed that each child is a genius. And that's the philosophy, and that's the belief we parents and adults must imbibe. that each child is a genius. You know, I was just a child when I first heard about Gandhiji, as I was talking to Amish. And at that little age, I really did not understand the depth of his philosophies. But my father would always give me little books that were written for children. Now, this book, Our Bapu, is written by Begum Zaidiji. And it's beautiful. It's filled with lovely stories about how Gandhiji, you know, would make a little child understand who had, a habit of gluttony, and how he trained that child to make sure, with love and in a gentle way, changed him to really eat appropriately. Good behavior, manners, loving elders, loving everybody with equality. So there's so much that families, and especially children, can learn from our great Mahatma. And now I have something very exciting. We have children, and perhaps some adults as well, performing and singing bhajans for you all. They are from the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, right here in London, and various other institutes. This is exciting. Let's go.
Vaishnava janan ko tene kai and wish you all a very happy Gandhi Jayanti. We're delighted to be offering our humble tribute to the great Mahatma through Indian classical dance. And on behalf of the performing artists, I'd like to thank the Nehru Center for this wonderful opportunity. Our first performance is by Divya Ravi, a Bharatanatyam dancer based in Kent. Divya has evolved as a respectable soloist, performing at various coveted dance festivals across the globe. She will be presenting the very popular Meera Bhajan, Hari Tumharo, a favourite of Gandhiji. Gandhiji really wished for the great singer M.S. Subbalakshmi to sing this bhajan. And so, the legendary singer recorded this bhajan on the 1st of October at the AIR Studios in Chennai, and it was airlifted and presented to Gandhiji on his 78th birthday. Presenting Divya Ravi in Hari Tumharo, a rendition by Bombay Jayashree, performance and choreography by Divya Ravi.
Hari Tum Haro Jan Ke Peer Hari Tum Haro Jan Ke लाज राखे तुम बढ़ायो चीर द्रौपदी की लाज राखे द्रौपदी की लाज राखे द्रौपदी की लाज राखे तुम बढ़ायो चीत हरि तुम हरो जन की पीर द्रौपदी की लाज राखी तुम बढ़ायो चीत हरि तुम हरो जन की वीर भक्त कारण रूप नर हरि धरो आप शरीर भक्त कारण रूप नर हरि धरो आप शरीर हरि न कश्यप मारलीन हो हरि न कश्यप मारलीन हो धर्यो नागिन धीर हरि तुम हरो जन की हरे तुम हरो जन के वीर हरे
Our next performance is by Paya Ramachandani, a Kuchipudi dancer based in Newcastle. Paya has performed extensively on the global stage and has evolved her own unique vocabulary of dance, reflected in her innovative choreographies. Today she will be presenting a Tamil composition by Sethu Madhava Rao, which was composed shortly after the demise of Mahatma Gandhi. Shanti Nilava Vendu, let peace prevail. He reminds us of all the qualities that the Mahatma tried to instill in us, like mercy, unity, ahimsa. In her interpretation, Payal has used the symbolism of the charkha, embodying self-sufficiency and unity, which is at the center of this network called society. Payal wishes to leave the viewers with one pressing question. Is this the society that Gandhiji had envisioned for us? Was this his vision? Shanti Nilava Vendu, choreography and performance by Paya Ramachandani, and a song sung by T.M. Krishna.
Gandhi Mahatma Kattali Adve Gandhi Mahatma Kattali aduve Gandhi Mahatma Kattali aduve Gandhi Mahatma Kattali aduve Gandhi Mahatma Kattali aduve Karuni Mutrumi Kadi Holi Paravi Gandhi Mahatma Kattali Aduve Karuni Ottrumai Kadi Holi Paravi Shanti Nilava Vendu Atma Shakti Onga Vendum Ulagile Shakti Onga Vendu Ulagile Shanti Nilava Vendu Atma Shakti Onga Vendu Ulagile Shanti Nilava Vendu கொடுமை செய்தியோர் மனமது தீர்ந்த நட்குணமதை புகட்டிடுவோம் கொடுமை செய்தியோர் மனமத தீரும் நக்குணமடை புகட்டிடை மடமையச்சம் அறுப்போம் மக்களின் மாசிலா நல்லொழுக்கம் வளர்ப்போம் மடமையச்சம் அறுப்போம் மக்களின் மாசிலா நல்லொழுக்கம் வளர்ப்போம் திடம் தரும் அஹிம்சா யோகி நம் தந்தை ஆத்மானந்தம் பெறவே இடம் தரும் அஹிம்சா யோகி நம் தந்தை ஆத்மானந்தம் பெறவே இடம் தரும் அஹிம்சா யோகி நம் தந்தை ஆத்மானந்தம் கடமை மறவோம் அவர் கடன் தீர்ப்போம் கலங்கமில் அறம் வளர்ப்போம் கடமை மறவோம் அவர் கடன் தீர்ப்போம் கலங்கமில் அறம் வளர்ப்போம் எங்கும் சாந்தி நிலவ வேண்டும் ஆத்ம சக்தி ஓங்க வேண்டும் உலகில் சாந்தி நிலவ வேண்டும் ஆத்ம சக்தி ஓங்க வேண்டும் உலகில் சாந்தி நிலவ ஆத்ம சக்தி ஓங்க வேண்டும் உலகில் சாந்தி உலகில் சாந்தி உலகில் சாந்தி நிலவ வேண்டும் எங்கும் சாந்தி எங்கும் சாந்தி எங்கும் சாந்தி
The next performance is by Kirsten Newell. Kirsten is a Bharatanatyam dancer, a Kalakshetra graduate based in Edinburgh, where she teaches, dances and creates along with Oksana Banshikova through her dance company Cosmic Dance. Kirsten pays her tribute to the Mahatma with a befitting song, our national song, Vande Mataram. Gandhiji was enthralled by the spirit of these two words. He said they embodied the national spirit. And so, he even concluded his letters not with yours faithfully or yours sincerely, but with Vande Mataram, Mohandas. Presenting Kirsten Newell in Vande Mataram, a choreography of Oksana Banshikova, and a song composed by A.R. Rahman.
बस तेरी याद थी जो मेरे
So my dear friends, with this we come to the end of our celebration, the wonderful Gandhi Jayanti special that was brought to you by Nehru Center London. I'd like to thank our dear Excellency, the High Commissioner of India to UK, Srimati Gayatri Kumar, our director at Nehru Center, Amish Tripathi, my wonderful team at Nehru Center, and each and every member of our community and everybody who's joined us today. Thank you so much. And I hope that we will aim and try to be a little of Gandhi in our day-to-day lives. He was a true rock star. Without Facebook, without Twitter, without Instagram, he took love and turned it into a broad-scale movement. So let's not just celebrate his birthday with empty rituals. Let's truly celebrate his virtues. There is much more to life than speed. And where there is love, there is life. So namaste, assalamu alaikum, and I wish you a happy Gandhi Jayanti. Much love and peace.